Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Bicycle Built for Murder by Kate Kingsbury, narrated by Mary Sarah. Chapter 1. The small formation of Spitfires swooped low over the eastern coastline. Their wings cast squat grey shadows across the wheat fields and the roofs of the tiny flint cottages perched on the cliffs below. The drone of their engines disturbed the quiet summer peace of the English countryside and raised the heads of cows grazing in Farmer John Miller's pastures. In the sloping main street of Sitting Marsh, housewives laden with bulging shopping bags pause to glance up at the aircraft, reassured by the blue and red circle painted on each wing. They continue trudging past the antiquated shops and narrow alleyways, their minds focusing once more on how to make a meal from the meager rations allowed them. A little way out of town, in a twisting lane bordered by high hedgerows, a motorcycle wound its way around the bends. The woman riding it clung to a handlebar with one confident hand and blew a kiss as the planes passed overhead. Lady Elizabeth Hartley Compton, along with the entire population of the beleaguered British Isles, harboured a tremendous pride and gratitude for the valiant men who flew those illustrious machines. Still clinging with one hand, she shaded her eyes against the sun to watch the aircraft disappear into a fluffy bank of cloud. Her inevitable ache of nostalgia was becoming easier to bear nowadays. It had almost been 2 years since both her parents had died during the Blitz on London. She would never again see a plane fly overhead without thinking about a loss. The next turn came up sooner than she expected, and even with the sidecar bouncing alongside her, she had to grab the handlebars and lean rather far to the left to make the corner. She really should pay attention, she reminded herself. To be tossed off the motorcycle were not only smart, but it was bound to ruin the yellow silk frock she wore. As it was, the necessity of having to tuck the skirt up under her knees tended to put creases in the worst places. There were times when she doubted the wisdom of riding a motorcycle. She'd had to replace the ornamental daisies on her straw boater at least 3 times, thanks to the wind. Violet, her aging housekeeper, kept badgering her to buy a motor car. Violet considered it improper for a 31-year-old woman of Lady Elizabeth's standing to be riding a vulgar motorcycle in public when she should be driven around in a Daimler. Violet was very good at suggesting ways to spend money. The trouble was, there was very little money to spend, certainly not enough to lavish on a motor car, let alone a chauffeur. Elizabeth lowered her chin as a salty gust of east wind nearly lifted her hat from her head, despite the anchors of pins and the wide elastic band. Actually, she rather enjoyed riding a motorcycle. It gave one a sense of utter freedom, much like flying, she supposed. Not that she'd ever flown. Still, she could well imagine how it must feel. At any rate, she knew very well that when she roared into town on her noisy steed, she commanded attention. If there was one thing Elizabeth considered important above all others, it was the ability to command attention. It was the only way to get things done. Having so justified her choice of transportation, she chugged and sputtered up the hill toward the long driveway that would take her home to the manor house. She had about a half mile to go when a few yards down the road, a woman appeared at a white lattice garden gate and frantically waved a large handkerchief at her. Even at that distance, Elizabeth could tell that Winnie Pierce was distraught about something. Winnie's family had been tenants of the Wellsboro estate for as long as Elizabeth could remember. When she'd inherited the manor house upon the death of her parents, she'd also inherited the cottages, on the vast acres that went with it. Which was just as well, since her miserable ex-husband had gambled away every penny of her inheritance. The rent from those cottages was the only thing standing between herself and abject poverty. Not that the tenants knew that, of course. It might weaken her authority if the residents of Sitting Marsh knew their chief adviser and protector was struggling to keep the manor house and all its holdings afloat in a sea of debts. Elizabeth was well aware that the 17th century Jacobean mansion, with its warm brick walls and towering windows, was a symbol of stability in a world gone mad. The imposing ancestral home visibly dominated the rural landscape, and the villagers looked upon those ancient walls as proof that the old world still existed and would go on existing long after the Germans and their vicious Luftwaffe had done their worst. Symbols as powerful as that had to be maintained, no matter the cost. She owed it to her people and to her family, whose traditions and heritage must be upheld. The residents of Sitting Marsh always came first. It was as simple as that. Which was why she braked to a sudden stop in front of Winnie Pierce, at great risk to her perilous control of the machine. The maneuver pitched her forward, and she bumped her chin painfully on the handlebar. She ran a tongue over her teeth to make sure they were all intact before climbing off as gracefully as one could manage under the circumstances. Winnie flapped her apron up and down in front of her round face, which glowed like a ripe tomato. She smelled faintly of onions and garlic, and a smudge of flour adorned her left cheek. Elizabeth immediately felt hungry. Having sampled the results of some of Winnie's delectable culinary skills in the past, she rather hoped her tenant would invite her to a midday meal. Violet did her best, but cooking was not one of her greatest achievements. And now that everything was rationed, the housekeeper's offerings were becoming decidedly insipid.
"I'm so sorry, Lady Elizabeth," Winnie said breathlessly. "I know I shouldn't have stopped you, but I've been so worried. I'm at wit's end, really I am."
Concerned by the poor woman's obvious agitation, Elizabeth patted her plump shoulder. "It's quite all right, Winnie. Just calm down and tell me what's the matter."
"Well, I don't rightly know, mum. It's Beryl, you see."
Elizabeth took a moment to smooth up a fold in her skirt. Beryl was Winnie's 16-year-old daughter, an only child and thoroughly spoiled. Beryl's promiscuous activities were a hot topic for the town and a source of great worry for her poor parents. Elizabeth had taken it upon herself to talk some sense into the child, whose overdeveloped attributes drew attention from the boys like flies to a dustbin. Beryl had listened politely and completely ignored the proffered counsel. Half afraid to ask, Elizabeth murmured, "I do hope she isn't sick."
"Oh no, mum. At least I don't think so."
To Elizabeth's dismay, the poor woman burst into tears. It was a moment or two before she'd sufficiently recovered herself enough to speak.
"She's missing, mum. She's been gone since Sunday. That's 2 whole days.
The news appeared worse than Elizabeth had anticipated. But then, Beryl was quite capable of causing her mother distress, simply on a whim. "Perhaps she's hiding out with a friend somewhere," she said soothingly. "Are any of her clothes missing? Did you have an argument with her?"
"No, nothing like that."
Winnie uttered a shuddering sigh, accompanied by a loud sniff, but at least she seemed to have stopped crying for the moment.
"The last time I saw her, which was Saturday afternoon, she went out of here as happy as a lark. Said she was going to meet Evan. Only Evan says she never turned up."
Elizabeth raised her eyebrows. "She's still going out with Evan? I thought that had finished weeks ago." Winnie shook her head.
"It's been on again, off again since then. But Beryl seemed really keen to see him on Saturday. She even left early. Evan said they weren't supposed to meet until 7 o'clock. But Beryl left here about 5:30.
Did she say where she was meeting him?
Never said a word. You know our Beryl. I'm surprised she even told me that much. But Evan told me they'd arranged to meet outside the Tudor Arms. He was going to take her to the dance in North Horsham.
What did he do when she didn't arrive?
Went off in a huff, that's what. Never even bothered to find out what happened to her. I had to go down to the farm on Sunday night and ask if he'd seen her. That's when I found out she hadn't turned up. Winnie twisted her hands in her apron. Wherever she went on Saturday night, it wasn't with Evan. I didn't see her come in, but I heard her all right. I was half asleep, but I called out to her. She never answered me, little bugger.
Did she say anything the next morning? Winnie shook her head.
She was gone by the time I got up. Never made her bed before she went out, neither. Strange, really. Our Beryl never can get up in the mornings without me yelling up the stairs, until I'm hoarse. Whatever got her out of the house that early on a Sunday must have been really important.
It was Elizabeth's considered opinion that Beryl was allowed far too much freedom for a young girl, which was bound to have adverse effects. She refrained from voicing the sentiment, however, and tried to be practical about the problem. Have you had a word with George? He might have seen her on his rounds. She actually saw Winnie's face turn white.
The police? Oh, no, ma'am. I couldn't. I don't want to get my Beryl into trouble. No more than what she is already, anyhow.
As far as George Dalrymple was concerned, Elizabeth didn't really think of him as being the police. Along with his colleague, Sid Goffin, he'd been brought out of retirement when the younger and considerably more efficient constables had been called up for the army. George had been very happy pottering around his little garden all day and had not taken kindly to being hauled away from his well-earned peaceful existence. Faced with the demand to do something for the war effort, however, he'd been powerless to refuse. His services were given grudgingly, at best, and as infrequently as he could manage. I don't think George would make trouble for Beryl, Elizabeth assured Winnie.
Maybe not, Winnie said firmly. But I don't want to do anything that might hurt my Beryl's reputation.
It was on the tip of Elizabeth's tongue to point out that it was a tad too late to worry about the child's reputation. She held her silence, while Winnie stared down the road, as if expecting to see her errant offspring appear at any minute.
If only Stan was here,
Winnie murmured unhappily.
He always knew how to handle our Beryl. She's been such a handful since he left to join the Navy. A young girl needs a father around. That's what I always say.
At a loss for any brilliant suggestions, Elizabeth shook her head. It's a hard time for all of us. Wartime demands sacrifices from all of us, and we just have to make the best of it. That's all.
Yes, ma'am.
Winnie gave a loud sniff.
I wouldn't be surprised if all this didn't have something to do with them Yanks.
Elizabeth blinked. The war? Oh, I don't think the Americans had anything to do with it. It's Hitler's fault. He started it all. Winnie looked startled.
No, ma'am. I mean Beryl disappearing like that. She's always talking about the Yanks and going to the base. I've strictly forbidden it, of course. A young girl of her age wouldn't stand a chance out there with all them barbarians, from what I've heard. It's no wonder girls get a bad name if they're seen talking to him. I wouldn't let my child near him.
Elizabeth's sense of justice could not let that go by without some form of protest. I'm sure they're not as bad as people like to make out. They are young men, after all, who have come very far from home to help fight this dreadful war, and we should be grateful for their presence here. Winnie gave her a sly look.
Would you go out with one, mum?
Appalled by the very idea, Elizabeth lifted her chin. Certainly not, Winnie nodded.
That's what I thought. All I'm saying is that Sitting Marsh hasn't been the same since they moved into that airport. What with all them girls coming in from the town and the land army girls elbowing them out the way? There's no room in the Tudor Arms anymore for those would live here. The pub is always full of strangers. Noisy ones at that.
She glanced at Elizabeth at the corner of her eye.
At least, that's what they tell me,
she added hurriedly.
But then, as you say, it's wartime, and we have to make the best of things.
Indeed. Though it might be an idea to ask Ted Wilkins if he's seen Barrow, Elizabeth suggested. After all, he owns the pub, and he's there all the time. He might be able to help.
I suppose so.
Winnie stared down the road again.
I just wish Stan was here. He's so much better at this than I am.
Seeing Winnie's forlorn expression, Elizabeth was prompted to offer rashly, "Would you like me to see what I can do?" She was immediately rewarded by the other woman's expression of relieved gratitude.
Oh, would you, ma'am? I hate to ask, really I do, but I don't know which way to turn. I would be ever so grateful if you could find out where she is for me.
Well, I can't promise anything, Elizabeth said quickly. But I will do what I can. Please try not to worry. I'm sure she's just having a game with you.
If she is, I'll box her blinking ears when she gets home,
Winnie threatened darkly.
Thank you so much, Lady Elizabeth.
She glanced at her front door.
Would you like to come in for a nice cup of tea?
Oh, that's very kind of you. Elizabeth gazed longingly up the garden path. Winnie's cottage beckoned with an air of comfort and cosy serenity rarely found in the vast, empty rooms and hallways of the manor house. The tiny latticed windows, tucked beneath the thickly thatched roof and discreetly covered with white net curtains, were almost hidden behind masses of yellow marigolds burgeoning from the window boxes. Daisies, hollyhocks, and Canterbury bells lined the pebbled path, their graceful heads nodding in the sea breeze, enticing her to wander past their fragrance to the cosy warmth of Winnie's kitchen. With a sigh, Elizabeth resisted the impulse to take Winnie up on her offer. I really should be getting back. Violet worries so much when I'm out on the motorcycle. She's convinced I'm going to meet with some dreadful calamity on the road.
Winnie eyed the gleaming red machine with a dubious look on her face. If you don't mind my saying so, it is rather dangerous for a woman to ride one of those things. Not that it's any of my business, of course. It's just that I wouldn't want anything bad to happen to you. I don't know what Sitting Marsh would do without you, ma'am. Really, I don't. After losing Lord and Lady Wellsborough like that, no.
There's been an Earl of Wellsborough for as long as Sitting Marsh has been in existence.
It just doesn't seem right not to have one anymore.
Elizabeth felt a pang of resentment. Yes, well, it's unfortunate that women can't inherit an earldom. I'm sure my father would have preferred a son to whom he could hand down the title, but we can't all have everything we want.
Winnie's face flushed with dismay. Oh, no, ma'am. I didn't mean anything by it. Really, I didn't. You've done wonders for the village. Really, you have. There isn't one person living in Sitting Marsh who doesn't regard you with the highest respect and admiration. We all love you dearly, Lady Elizabeth. Every last one of us. Really.
Appeased by this outburst, Elizabeth relented. She was well aware that her sensitivity stemmed not so much from Winnie's remark, or for that matter, a lack of title, but from the fact that her mother had never been truly accepted by the villagers. Elizabeth's mother, Mavis, had been nothing more than a 15-year-old kitchen maid when she'd caught the eye of Lord Hartley. He'd eventually married her, much to the horror of the villagers, and Nigel Hartley's father, the Earl of Wellsborough. Although Mavis had quickly learned the customs and manners of an aristocrat and had looked every inch the part, her lack of family breeding had remained a barrier between her and society for the rest of her short life. Despite the fact that no mention of Elizabeth's diverse heritage had ever been uttered by anyone in Sitting Marsh, she was constantly aware that the disparity remained in her background, and no doubt would be handed down to future generations, if there were to be any. The way things looked now, there was plenty of room for doubt, she reminded herself as she continued on her way, having assured Winnie that no offence had been taken. Her marriage to Harry Compton had lasted less than 9 years. Fortunately, as it turned out, there had been no child from that marriage. Though in weaker moments, Elizabeth found herself dealing with a deep sense of missing something important in her life. Her experiences with her ex-husband, however, had left her with a strong aversion to romantic entanglements and a profound mistrust of men in general. Although her sense of fair play cautioned her that to lump all men into one odious category was not exactly cricket, her outraging contempt over Harry's betrayal had deeply wounded her, and this was one area where she was simply unable to rationalize. If Beryl had any sense, she'd stay away from men altogether, Elizabeth thought sourly, as she pulled up at the wrought iron gates that opened onto the manor house grounds. She only hoped the poor girl hadn't run off with someone the way she had done so herself 10 years ago. If so, more than likely, Beryl would live to regret it. Her dark thoughts scattered as she rode up the long driveway to the house. Passing through the wooded land with its myriad wildlife on either side of her always brought her a sense of peace, even in these turbulent times. Fortunately, London and the major cities were too far away for Sitting Marsh to suffer the horrors of the bombing, so far at least. But even the petty annoyances and the inconveniences of wartime seemed to fade into insignificance whenever Elizabeth saw the red brick walls of the manor house coming into view around the tree-lined bend. How she loved this sprawling ancient mansion, in spite of its empty rooms, the plumbing problems, the leaking roofs, and drafty windows. This was her home, her heritage. This was what she lived for, worked for, prayed for with every fiber of her being. Who needed a man, she asked herself, her spirits rising as she sputtered to a stop in front of gleaming white marble steps. Who needed a man when she had all this? This was her life. These stately grounds and proud, magnificent walls, with their centuries of history locked behind them. This was who she was and always would be. Lady Elizabeth Hartley Compton, daughter of the Earl and Countess of Wellsborough. She was home. It was only then that she noticed the vehicle parked on the other side of the circular driveway. It seemed she had a visitor. Moreover, by the looks of the dilapidated jeep resting against her flower bed, the intruder was one of that much maligned species, an American. Now what on earth would an American be doing at the manor house? Feeling a deep sense of foreboding, Elizabeth hurried up the steps of her ancestral home and prepared herself for the worst. Chapter 2. The heavy oak door opened slowly to Elizabeth's urgent summons on the clanging bell. Many times she thought about replacing the historical pool bell with a modern electric buzzer. Thank heavens her father had the foresight to have electricity installed in the house while there was still money to pay for it. The bell, however, belonged to an era long since gone. A and Elizabeth was reluctant to part with one of the fast-vanishing remnants of those idealistic times. She often thought how wonderful it must have been to live in an age when women were cherished and pampered. Nowadays, women were expected to act like men, taking the place of their male counterparts in factories, shops, and farms all over the country. Women wore trousers, drove lorries, dug ditches, and built airplanes. Sometimes it was hard to tell they were women at all. Well, she might ride a motorcycle, Elizabeth assured herself. She would never be seen in public without a decent frock and a hat, albeit at great inconvenience to herself at times. Still, appearances had to be kept up. Always a lady, as her mother had reminded her again and again. The door finally opened wide enough for her to step inside the wide entrance hall, though the person behind it remained hidden. The familiar smell of furniture polish mingled with the fragrance of freshly picked roses, reminding her sharply of her mother. Shaking off the painful twinge, Elizabeth put one foot on the embroidered welcome mat, protecting the polished parquet floor, and inquired cautiously, "Martin?" She heard a faint scuffle of feet, and Martin's crinkled face appeared from behind the door.
"Goodness gracious, madam. Whatever are you doing out there without an escort?"
Elizabeth sighed. Martin had been with the family since before the turn of the century. He had long ago outlived his usefulness as a butler, though he was completely unaware of that fact, thanks to Elizabeth's determination to give the doddery old man a home for as long as he needed one. She, and for the most part Violet too, turned a blind eye to his faltering memory and occasional bouts of dementia. Although his spirit remained as willing as ever, his body was often too weak to comply, and Elizabeth gamely undertook his duties, while making every effort to convince the senile gentleman that he was still in full possession of his faculties. That wasn't always as simple as it sounded, considering that a large amount of the time Martin lived in the past, when he and the modern world were still in their guileless youth. She gave him a fond smile and gently closed the door with his hand still clinging stubbornly to the ornate brass handle. "Thank you, Martin. I see we have a visitor."
"We do?"
Martin blinked owlishly at her over the thin gold rims of his glasses. He never could get the hang of looking through them, and constantly blundered into whatever obstacle happened to be in his path. "The jeep," Elizabeth said helpfully. "It looks like an American vehicle."
"Does it really?"
Martin shook his head. His white hair had thinned until just a few wisps remained, which he insisted on having trimmed every week or so, at great risk of losing what little hair he had left. Violet pretended to snip at the strands for him, until he was satisfied that he looked respectable. Elizabeth tried again. "Did you happen to see the driver of the jeep?" Martin's watery blue eyes peered anxiously at her.
"Perhaps if Madam could enlighten me as to the nature of a jeep. I'm not familiar with that term."
"It's a motor vehicle, Martin. You know, like a carriage without a horse?" Martin nodded.
"Ah, one of those newfangled contraptions. I trust you are not contemplating setting foot in one of those death machines."
"Of course not, Martin."
"I should certainly hope not. Your father would turn in his grave."
"No doubt." Elizabeth glanced at the door on her left, which stood slightly ajar. "Martin, would you please ask Violet to send some tea and sandwiches to the library? Is Polly still here?"
"I think so, madam. I'll see to it right away."
Martin inclined his head, then twisted around until he was facing toward the steps that led to the kitchen. He shuffled a few steps, then halted. Elizabeth waited until he'd maneuvered his body so that he was facing her again, then asked gently, "What is it, Martin?" He shuffled back toward her and whispered loudly,
"You can't go in the library, madam. There's a gentleman in there."
"That's quite all right, Martin. I'll use the utmost caution. Besides, Polly will be along any moment with the sandwiches, all right?"
"Oh, yes, sandwiches. I'll have her bring them right away."
"And tea, Martin?" She glanced again at the library door. "Perhaps you should have her bring some sherry as well." Martin shuffled off, muttering to himself and repeating his mission over and over as he climbed painfully down the stairs. Elizabeth waited until he'd reached the bottom safely, then headed for the library. The visitor had his back to her when she silently entered the quiet room. He was studying the rows of books, her father's books, that lined the shelves from floor to ceiling. Her father had been a great reader and had collected just about every piece of classical literature published. Elizabeth took advantage of the moment to study the stranger. He wore the forest green uniform of an American Air Force pilot, which was becoming a familiar sight in Sitting Marsh. His hands were clasped behind his back, and his broad shoulders were squared in a typical military stance. She must have made some slight sound as he turned sharply and impaled her with eyes so light blue. They appeared to have little colour at all. The contrast against his leathery, sunburned skin was startling. When he swept off his cap, she saw streaks of blonde in his light brown hair. This was a man who lived outdoors, in the hot sun. How he must miss that here in the cool mists of England. "Good afternoon," she said, surprised to hear the tremor in her voice. She felt a little intimidated by the man's presence, and it wasn't a feeling to which she was accustomed. It had to be the uniform. This was the closest she'd been to an American. In some of the wild tales she'd heard about them, gleefully circulated in her head.
"Ma'am?"
He offered his hand. Then, as if unsure of the gesture, he withdrew it again.
"Major Monroe, United States Air Force. I'm here to see the owner of this establishment."
He had a deep burr of an accent that made her think of cowboys in wide open plains. She nodded warily. "That would be me." He stared at her for so long, she wondered if she had mud all over her face. Riding a motorcycle had more than one disadvantage. She raised her hands to her hat, just to reassure herself it was still anchored in her hair and not hanging down her back, as it had been known to happen in the past.
"You're Lady Wellsborough,"
he said at last, sounding utterly amazed. "Lady Elizabeth, actually," she said pleasantly. "There is no Lady Wellsborough." Now he looked confused.
"But I was told that Lady Wellsborough owned this place."
"Then you were misinformed. Lady Wellsborough was my mother. She was married to Lord Wellsborough, my father, who was the Earl of Wellsborough. I, however, am known as Lady Elizabeth. It all has to do with the inheritance of titles, which is terribly biased in favour of men, and completely outdated, as far as I'm concerned. In any case, it would take far too long to explain it all now."
"Yes, ma'am."
For a moment he seemed to struggle with the information she'd given him, then apparently gave up. His gaze flicked over her.
"I was kind of expecting someone a lot older."
"Sorry to disappoint you. How may I be of service, Major Monroe? That is what one calls you, isn't it? I'm not familiar with American customs. I wasn't aware that you had majors in the Air Force."
"Army Air Force, ma'am. Though I'd rather you call me Earl."
She lifted her chin, sensing he was making fun of her. "We usually reserve that title for gentlemen of nobility. His laugh took her by surprise.
No, ma'am. That's my name. Earl Monroe. At least that's what it says on my birth certificate.
Oh, I see. Now she felt foolish and annoyed at him for making her so. Excuse me. I've never heard of anyone being called Earl before.
Well, I've never met the daughter of one before, so I reckon that makes us even. So, what do I call the daughter of an Earl?
As I've already told you, I'm known as Lady Elizabeth. His eyes crinkled at the corners.
All the time?
All the time, Elizabeth said firmly. He nodded, then swept a long glance around the library, taking in the high, ornate ceiling carved centuries ago. The majestic windows with their imposing view of the grounds, the vast open fireplace, an Italian marble mantelpiece, right down to the deep blue Axminster carpet.
Quite a palace you have here.
Elizabeth smiled, pleased by his warm admiration of her treasured domain. Thank you, but it's not a palace. It's a mansion.
What's the difference?
She wasn't sure. But she was reluctant to let him know that. In England, the word palace usually refers to the home of royalty. That sounded right, anyway.
And you're not?
Royalty? Not exactly. Nobility, I suppose, would describe it more accurately.
Could I look around?
Why, of course. A faint tap on the door interrupted her. The door opened. And a young girl edged in, carrying a large tray. Elizabeth was happy to see Polly wearing a dress. She was only a part-time maid, and lately had taken to wearing trousers to work, despite Elizabeth's protests. Today she pinned up her long dark hair into a tight coil circling around her head. No doubt the latest fashion of some film star garnered from a motion picture magazine. You can put the tray down there, Polly, Elizabeth said, indicating a small table in the bay window. Polly gaped at the American as she carried the tray past him and dumped it rather heavily on the table. Still staring at him, she backed away a few steps, then turned and rushed from the room. Elizabeth sighed.
When I was a child, a maid would never have dared to behave in such an atrocious manner.
But then, it's almost impossible to get decent help these days. She started toward the table. May I offer you a glass of sherry and a sandwich?
Oh, that's real kind of you, ma'am. But I have to get back to the base.
Oh, somewhat nonplussed, she turned to face him.
In that case,
you'd better tell me why you are here.
Yes, ma'am.
Earl Monroe stared down at the cup he was twisting in his hand. Elizabeth felt a small jump of apprehension when she realized the American was reluctant to give her the reason for his visit. Somehow, she didn't think it was simply idle curiosity that had brought him to the manor house. She waited, heart thumping, for him to raise his head.
I'm sorry, ma'am,
he said finally.
I've been ordered to inform you that your home is being requisitioned to house American officers for an unknown period of time.
It took her a full 10 seconds to comprehend his words. In the long silence that followed his statement, she heard quite clearly the loud tick of the grandfather clock in the hallway. And somewhere downstairs, a door slammed. No doubt, Polly, on her way out, American officers. Here, in one of the most cherished stately homes in England? That's impossible, she said bluntly. Major Monroe at least had the grace to look unhappy.
I reckon there isn't much any of us can do about it, ma'am. The airbase isn't big enough to accommodate the men as well as the officers. Yours is the only establishment within miles that would suit our purposes.
Well, we'll see about that. I'll call Whitehall. I'll call the Prime Minister. I'll call the palace. This is an outrage. She stared in consternation as Munro tucked his fingers into his breast pocket and withdrew a slip of paper.
I reckon you should take a peek at this, ma'am.
The paper trembled in her fingers when she scanned the typewritten lines. There was no mistake. The dictate bore the stamp of the War Office. For a long moment she struggled with her resentment, then reminded herself, as she had so many times, that there was a war on. Just last year the government had passed a National Service Act conscripting women between the ages of 20 and 30 for either military or vital war purposes. There were rumors that the limit would be raised to 50 years of age before too long. It was only a matter of time. She might as well start doing her bit right now. At least she'd be allowed to stay in her own home. But she didn't have to like it. She turned to gaze out the window, appalled at the thought of her home being overrun by the hooligans who had become the terror of the town. When will this take place? He must have heard the tremor in her voice.
Next week, ma'am. I'm real sorry we have to do this. But I swear to you, they're all swell guys. They'll keep out of your way as much as possible, and they'll do their best not to disrupt the household. I'll see to it myself.
Thank you, Major Munro, Elizabeth murmured. But I think we both know that life at the manor house will be somewhat different for a while.
Yes, ma'am. Let's just hope it won't be for too long.
Amen. She headed for the door, saying over her shoulder.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.